is pursuing us with all of his love and all of his heart. And when we get to encounter that love, you're changed. You're never going to be the same. Because once you experience real love, I don't care if it's whether you're in the darkest part of your life and you cry out help and he shows up. Or if you're at the highest of heights and you're standing and you're just reveling in the beauty and majesty of who he is, and you know that you're encountering God in that event, you're forever changed. No, we're going to do the one that we had a song request this morning.
Shout out.
Yeah, shout out. Hello, my name is.
Oh, right on.
Yeah, freestyle shout out.
Freestyle.
We're gonna win this one.
Yeah, there was like four or five worship songs. Yeah.
But it was mostly pastors that came
It was really good. It was awesome. All right, so this is a word from the Lord today. Courage, my child. Courage. Courage. This is a day of following in the footsteps of your Lord. A day of forsaking the false and embracing the truth. Dark shadows must be left for the brilliant light of a new day. I am calling you, child, to take me as your guide. Stay at my side, and I will walk you through the obstacles that lie ahead. I am your savior, and I will rescue you from harm. Courage, my child. The days will bring you many joys and yet many challenges. I will speak to the earth, and it will open up its treasures to you. I will speak to the heavens, and they will open their treasures to you. You will advance in a pace that will seem too fast. Yet it is the wind of my spirit, we had that word earlier this week, that will take you along. You will be courageous, for I am with you, and you will rejoice in the day of battle, for I am endless strength for you. Many are distracted in gazing on the trinkets of life. Your eyes must be fixed on the prize, the great reward of knowing that I am enough. You will take my right hand and be my overcomer, and nothing will be able to disturb you when I am near. You will not taste defeat, but you will rise on wings of eagles and soar over the mountains that seem to intimidate you. I am the everlasting Father, the fountain of peace. So be strong in my strength, convinced of my love, and you will not stumble. Courage, my child. Psalm 28, verses 7 through 9 in the Passion Translation say, you are my strength and my shield from every danger. When I fully trust you, help is on the way. Amen. I jump for joy and burst forth with ecstatic, passionate praise. Yeah. I will sing songs of what you mean to me. All right, we can't just read this. Right. We pretty much need to do something about this. Okay. When I fully trust you, help is on the way. Okay, get ready, because there's a word here that we need to receive this morning. I jump for joy.
Yeah!
And I burst forth with ecstatic, passionate praise.
Yeah!
I will sing songs. I will sing songs of what you mean to me. You will be the inner strength of all of your people, the mighty protector of all, the saving strength for all your anointed ones. Keep protecting and cheering your chosen ones. In you, they will never fall. Like a shepherd going before us, keep leading us forward, forever carrying us in your arms. Amen. We're going to start singing because that's what it told us to do. Hello, my name is Fri May. Thank you.
So our son from Hawaii, John, sent me something yesterday, because we don't watch the news. Because most of it's bad news. But yesterday there was some really good news. President Trump signed an executive order that does away with the Johnson Amendment from 1954 that said that pastors, churches, ministries could not speak about political things or they would lose their tax deductible contributions, status, and nonprofit status. He had promised to do that, and I think it's significant that he chose the National Day of Prayer to sign that. Yeah, and it was the first time in 8 years that the National Day of Prayer was led by a president. have been called in, and he called in special people to do that because he knew he was going to sign this in. And so I just think it was very significant as we joined across the nation, people praying. So no more gag order.
Right.
No more gag order. We can speak about what God wants us to speak about. And we don't even have a pulpit. They called it the pulpit gag order. We don't have a pulpit. Wonder if it counts.
I don't believe
it. Is that good news?
Yeah.
That is great news. I'll tell you, I've really never been afraid of that law or that amendment.
Never
really abided by it. But it's good to know that from the top down, what was declared yesterday, that our country was founded on faith, and that our freedom is not from government, our freedom is from God. And that was declared yesterday in the Rose Garden at the White House. Amen. That is just exciting things. So I was reading the Second Chronicles passage yesterday because that's always the verse of the day, all right? Second Chronicles 7:14, everybody knows that passage, but it talks about when we humble ourselves, call on His name, seek His face, repent, and turn to God, He will hear from heaven and heal our land. And I believe that God is healing our land. But I was looking at the context of that whole story, because this was the story when Solomon dedicated the temple and God showed up. The very first verse, this is how God shows up, guys. Let me get back there. When Solomon finished dedicating the temple, fire came down from the sky and burned up the offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple.
Yeah. We had fire come down last night, you know the...
Yes, we did. In fact, as we were driving home from Celebrate Recovery, God was showing off clear across. It was almost like the Midwest storm. It was incredible. Clear across the sky over the Cascades, there was an incredible light show. And it was just every few seconds, constant. Did anybody else see that? It was just spectacular. Amen. I love it. Thank you, Lord. Okay. But there was something that really jumped out at me. When Solomon finished praying, let me get back to that scripture. Oh, then the Lord appeared. This is verse 12. The Lord appeared to Solomon at night and said to him, Solomon, I have heard your prayer, and I have chosen this place for myself to be a house of worship. And I just kind of went, wow. Well, first of all, you can't believe all the preparation that went into that temple. What God had put on, there's just chapters and chapters about what had taken place, right? And how David had given all of his wealth and then had challenged the leaders and challenged the people to do the same, to build this temple of God. But they get all done, and God says, okay, I choose this place. And I thought that was significant because Paul says, don't you know that you are the temple? And we can make lots of preparation, but God chooses.
Right.
You hear what I'm saying? So the right preparation determines how God comes. And I've often wondered, why does God move here or move there and does spectacular things? And I think a lot of it has to do with how we prepare the temple.
Amen.
Amen? I really believe that, first of all, here's the heart of God. He quotes it out of the Old Testament, but Jesus got really upset. He said, my house will be a house of prayer. And it's significant because what was happening there, it wasn't just about doing business in the temple. They had set up in the area of the courtyard where the Gentiles, the non-Jews, were able to come and worship at the temple. Did you know that? That's what had happened there. And Jesus came in and said, What's going on here? Somebody is being prevented from worshiping God and praying. Coming in and praying. My house is a house of prayer. And I believe the significance of that, I'll wrap all this together, all right? I believe God is moving in Roseburg in Douglas County because his temple is about prayer. His temple is about prayer. A lot of years, when Christy and I first got here, I started looking for people of prayer. The first person that somebody told me, go see Jan Finley.
Yeah.
And that was over at the old building, Lee. And I went and met Jan. She was one of the first persons I met. Bless her heart. So Jan Finley, today at noon, has helped put together a team of people that gather together the first Friday of every month to pray in our courthouse on the third level at noon every month. And she has been a faithful prayer warrior. Bless her. Bless Jan. She has been a faithful prayer warrior. She is one of the first persons I met in Douglas County in the churches because I was looking for people of prayer. And I have to tell you that for about 10 years, it was really a push to make sure that the National Day of Prayer happened. It really was. I would go and fill out the form and make sure that we were all okay. And then I would just try to rally and get the pastors going. And it was hard. It was hard. Well, I can tell you, it's been shifting. And yesterday really showed what's coming. I believe that whole courthouse steps and that whole front yard in front of the courthouse. courthouse is soon going to be filled in the National Day of Prayer. And then Daniel Malaputi from First Christian stated something. He said, we need to do this more often. Why wait? Just do it once a year. Amen? See, when we prepare ourselves through prayer, God shows up. God has shown up in Roseburg and Douglas County. And I believe that we just get to be a part of that and see what God is doing. Amen? So, Father, we prepare our temples more and more, God, every day, putting you first. For the first part of our day, we set apart for you, Lord, to set our day for you, to prepare our hearts in prayer and to worship you, God. And we expect you to show up. We expect you to show up in the people that we come in contact with today, God, and that you will be changing lives and your kingdom will come into the lives of people today because we've prepared your temple. Lord Jesus, I just hear your Holy Spirit. Lord, you want us to make sure as we prepare the temple, we get rid of the things that need to get out to open up room for you more and more. More, Lord, more of you, more of you, more of you in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
I believe that I've been changed. I have not felt like this ever. I was at the senior center yesterday and I said, is that Christopher? Yeah, I always bring with them. He's got me through a lot of stuff, and I just thank him for it. I didn't make it easy. And I finally realized last night, sitting at home, he doesn't need my help. He's not an awesome. I believe I stood in the way of the Lord. So, he's more precious to me today than it was yesterday. Okay, this is the one. Praise you, Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
I praise you with everything that is in me.
I praise you with everything that is in me.
I will never forget all the good things. Sickness and disease.
All my sickness and disease.
You redeem my life.
You redeem my life.
From the pit.
From the pit.
And you crown me with loving kindness and tender mercy.
Crown me with loving kindness and tender mercy.
You meet my every need.
You meet my every need.
And fill my life with good things.
And fill my life with good things.
So that my youth is renewed.
So that my youth is renewed.
Like the eagle.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. To all my fears.
says, you split the sea so I could walk right through it. Okay? What's the rest of the verse there?
My fears
were drowned in perfect love. Keep going.
You rescued me so I could stand and sing.
I am a child of God. Now I want to tell you that it worked the opposite way for me. I had to stand and sing. I am a child of God before the fear went.
Yeah.
He made the way on the cross. But the truth is that if you don't agree with what he did on the cross, if you don't agree with what's been done with you, for you, okay, on your behalf, then the enemy gets to mess with you still, okay?
Yeah.
So I had to stand and sing, I am a child of God. 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 And I had to tell all the things that were fearful to go. Go in Jesus' name, because I'm a child of God. You don't get to be here. So we don't deny the symptoms. We just say, you don't have a right to be in my life because of the blood of Jesus Christ. So that's how. He parts the sea and you can walk right through it and you can no longer be a slave to fear.
Amen.
We come here every morning and if our compass is off a little, we get to the true North Star. About the words we sing. But about fear, there's a lady, Kelly Copeland, and if she does nothing else in her life, and she does a lot, but if she did nothing else in her life, when her young child, there was an epidemic, and children were just dying every day, and the doctor came out to tell her that her child wasn't going to live till the next day. And see, we don't know what's going to happen today. But what's going to happen? And there she is, and that spirit of fear was really working on her. And she said, real strong, I refuse to fear. And that spirit left her. She felt that spirit leave her. A terrible spirit.
Amen.
So, I had some of that fear stuff. And I was struggling because I've been through a lot. How am I going to trust God now? You know, because I've seen a lot of pain and heartache and my house is burned to the ground. I've lost several relationships that were very dear to me and people. And it was painful. And Holly, came to my house and she taught me this little trick of taking a step to the left.
Right.
Whenever I felt pain or heartache or fear, I just step on out of it.
Right.
And I started doing that. And it works.
It's actually brain science, because it forces you to get out of the right side of your brain, which is the fight or flight part of your brain. And so it actually forces you to engage the left side of your brain, which is the part of your brain that gives you that ability to like reason and like not be so frantic in the situation that you're in. We do it all the time. Tell myself to think something different.
Where is
Thank you. look at them and we just see, oh, they're so blessed. Oh, they're just so special or something or other. And we think, and God, just we can just see how much God loves them. And I want you to say this after me. God loves you.
God loves you.
But I'm his favorite.
But I'm his favorite.
Tell that to yourself all day long. Okay? And every time you see someone that is especially blessed by God, you say, God loves you, but I'm his favorite. You don't say that to them. But I'm just saying, you say it to yourself. Okay? You don't say that to them. You just say that to yourself because you can say, yes, there's enough love to go around for you, but I'm his favorite. Okay? And so, if that's really true for all of us, that there's only the kind of God we have, we're all his favorite. And that's not cheapening the favoritism. Okay? That's not lessening the favoritism. You're his favorite. You're his favorite. He follows you around everywhere you go. He's bragging on you to the angels. He's telling everybody to come and watch what a good job you're doing and how proud he is of you and how beautiful you are and how spectacular you are and all the gifts that he's put in you and everything that he's marked out for your day and everything that you're going to accomplish in your life and all the destiny that he has for you.
Amen.
And you are his favorite.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you, and give you peace. In the name of Jesus, be blessed. Have a great day.